बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम। टुडे वी आर इन आवर सिक्स्थ लेक्चर ऑफ आवर रिसर्च मेथोडोलॉजी लेक्चर सीरीज एंड इन दिस लेक्चर्स वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट रिव्यू ऑफ लिटरेचर। हाउ वी डू रिव्यू ऑफ लिटरेचर, व्हाई वी डू रिव्यू ऑफ लिटरेचर, व्हाट इज द इम्पोर्टेंस ऑफ रिव्यूइंग लिटरेचर, व्हाट हेल्प डू वी गेट फ्रॉम द लिटरेचर दैट वी रिव्यू, हाउ टू डू इट क्रिटिकली, what kind of contents do we need when we write our literature review, and what are the sources of literature review. So today we are talking about sources of literature. Where do we get the already published material, where do we get the journal articles, where do we get book chapters that are relevant to our research questions and objectives. In the previous lecture we have talked about how we have to write the literature review, what are the importance, what are the important points, and why do we write literature review critically, what are the important elements to keep in mind when we have to write the literature, what are the things that make literature review critical. We have content evaluation slides where we saw how to evaluate the contents. For example, we saw that literature review must have a title. So we have to have a title rather than just writing a review of literature. We have to have a title of our chapter. We must give a title to our chapters. Then we decide about, or we talked about, the subsections of our literature review chapter that must be linked with each other. So if you are talking about a single chapter of literature review and it is divided into sub chapters, then they must be linked from each other so that one can understand what are the linkages between various theoretical frameworks, various research papers that have been conducted empirically on this or that sort of research inquiry. So for example, if we are reviewing literature related to marketing or human resource management and we are dividing that into, let's say, 3 or 4 sub chapters, so we have to see that how the first part of literature review is linked to the second part versus how second part is linked to the third part and how they all are linked together, so that we can conclude what are the main ideas that we can conduct, that we can relate to with various subsections of the literature review. What are the main focuses of empirical, qualitative, quantitative studies that are done on these particular areas of research? Thirdly, we can also understand what are the main findings that are there when we subdivide the literature review chapter. And so on, we can understand many things. One thing that we have to understand from while we are writing, that we have to see things critically. That's the most important element when one has to write a literature review chapter. It has been emphasized in last 3 to 4 lectures that we don't have to summarize the already existing studies. We have to see things analytically, critically, systematically, so that we can come up to a conclusion where we can not only pinpoint the drawbacks, the shortcomings of the already existing studies or literature, but also we will be in a position to say something about our contribution to that particular research inquiry. This is one of the important things that we have to learn and have to pinpoint when we are writing the chapter of literature review. So when we start writing, we have also seen that we have a upward moving circular flow of conducting research using various key terms and keywords, and then evaluating these researches based on inclusion exclusion criteria, and then we have to start writing our critical literature review. When we start, we have to think that our literature review must have a title. We write with purpose, that why we are writing. We have to understand the main objective of writing that chapter, and we have to evaluate contents based on the various sub sections and headings. One thing we have to keep in mind when we are writing that we don't lose our reader with the passage of time. Either we write two or three chapters, two, three pages of literature review, or we write a full-fledged 20, 25 pages chapter of literature review. We don't have to lose our reader in moving from one page to another page. So every section has back and forth linkages, and it must be self-explanatory so that people can easily understand that what we want to conclude from this subsection and what do we meant by when we write this subsection. So as such, this chapter or literature review chapter should be a separate self-explanatory systematically written chapter where we don't lose our readers. And this is the chapter which can also lead to the other chapters of the dissertation, for example, if you're writing a master dissertation. So we have to emphasize a lot when we start writing our literature review, that too critically. Now today we are talking about sources of literature. This is another important aspect of literature review. When we start reviewing literature that is already existing, we have to understand that from which sources or from where we can get the data. For example, if you want to have some published paper on the research inquiry we want to conduct, we have to think once or twice what are the sources from where we can have access to, let's say, journals, peer review articles, magazines, books, dissertations that are available, let's say, in the university library or organization's library where you're working for. So we have to see these things, and we have to do this thing in this literature search step by step. Today we will see how important it is and how we have to conduct this literature review and where do we find the sources. So there are three basic ways or three basic sources of literature. One is primary, another is secondary, and third one is tertiary. So what is primary, what is secondary, and what is tertiary? We'll definitely be talking about in detail about primary and secondary, but tertiary we will not be talking about in detail. We'll definitely briefly touch that source also. But for master dissertation, this is not that much important as compared to primary and secondary. So the most important thing is primary research things that are available to you, primary sources of literature search from where you can get the basic material, and then you follow up using secondary material. If you are doing a big project or a level study, let's say PhD dissertation, you'll definitely think about tertiary sources. In masters, you can also think about tertiary sources, but you don't have to go in depth about these tertiary sources. So what we include as literature sources in the primary sources of literature, they are like reports that are published. For example, if you're looking on things which are relevant to economy, economic growth, international stuff and all that. So one such thing is World Development Report that is published by World Bank every year, or Human Development Report that is published by UNDP, for example, or International Financial Statistics or Global Development Finance Report that is published by IMF and World Bank. So you have to see how these reports can help you to answer questions that are relevant to your research inquiry. Thesis, for example, that you can find in your research library, that you can find in the organization you are working for, maybe in the department library you are writing your dissertation. You can also get help from other libraries of various universities you are living in, and these kind of thesis and dissertation helps you to build on your further references from these dissertations and thesis. Emails are also important aspect of learning that, so you can write it to some expert, they can advise you, and that advice from email can also be used. Conference proceedings are, for example, are very important. For example, in Pakistan we have this Pakistan Society of Development Economics or some other conferences that held annually, and those who present their papers in these annual conferences, that papers are published as conference proceedings, and that paper published form papers are available through conference proceedings, and that can also be a helpful source of learning that what kind of new research or what kind of research actually people are doing on the topics that are relevant to your topic of research. Government publications, for example, Pakistan Bureau of Statistics is publishing number of publications that can help you a lot. Financial statistics, State Bank of Pakistan is writing research working papers. They are also writing annual reports. For example, if Ministry of Finance is publishing economic survey, so these are the government reports and publication that can help you to find out some basics about one or the other sector. So if you want to write some things that are helpful for educational management, for example, health management information system you want to write about. So these are the things that can help government publications to know basics about how these things are working. Unpublished manuscript, if you can have access to unpublished papers. Let's say some of your seniors have written some papers that are not yet published, but they are in the process of publication. But that are new research, that are cross-cutting research, that can help you to understand how things are working, especially relevant to the field of study you are interested in. Secondary sources are books, newspaper, and journals that are already published. Peer-reviewed journal papers, newspapers that every day you get, some editorials, articles that published in the newspaper, and books, of course, that are published, let's say, 3-4 years back, 10 years back, maybe 20 years back, if your topic of relevant are very important. For example, if you're writing about microfinance or poverty, these are important topics, so you can also have some good books that are published, let's say, 20 years back. You can have new books which are very relevant to you also, let's say, some books are published in 2011 or 12. So this is how your primary and secondary sources can help you to move further in getting access to the literature that you want to study, review, that helps you to clarify your research question as well as your research objective. Tertiary sources include abstracts that you can get. Some of the conferences publish proceedings, but only abstract. Rather than full papers, they publish only abstract. Somewhere in the online search, let's say from any university search, you can find abstracts by the author's website where they have written some papers on issues relevant to your research inquiry. So what you can do basically, you can read these abstracts and try to think whether they link to your research questions and objectives or not. If they don't link, it's fine, but if it is linked with where you are interested in, you can definitely write to the authors, you can write to the editors of these particular pages, or wherever you can have access to, you can actually write to them and get access to these things. Catalogs, for example, in libraries, you can find these catalogs. Encyclopedia are very important sources to get some basic definitions and understanding. Dictionaries, for example, where you can get meanings of words and all that. Bibliographies can also help you. So these are the tertiary sources where if you are writing from very basic aspect of some things to a very detailed aspect. So most of these tertiary sources can help you understand things when you are writing bigger projects, longer projects, let's say, for example, a PhD dissertation. But at master's level, the most important sources that can help you immediately and that can have access for you in quick or earlier stages of your master's research is basically primary and secondary sources of literature search. We have discussed what are these primary, secondary, and tertiary sources. Now we will see, for example, how various things actually exist and how we can access them. So first we are talking about refereed and academic journals. What are they, how do they help us, why they are important, and why we have to look into these journals. So journals are also known as periodical, serials or magazines, and are published on regular basis. So one thing that is very important is that they published on regular basis. So published on regular basis actually help us to understand that if things are moving with the passage of time in the same line of inquiry, you can also have access to an article, let's say, that is published 10 years back. versus an article which is just published, let's say 3-4 months back. So you can have access to older articles versus very latest articles. So journals are vital literature source for any research. These are the most important. So the first thing that you start looking while you start writing your master's proposal or dissertation is a journal that can be refereed, that can be academic. So you can actually start searching journals through one or the other means. If you are in a university which is HEC recognized university, so HEC have this digital library from where you can access various journals. You can have access to, let's say, ISI Web of Knowledge, where number of journals are also subscribed. You can have access to Springer, which is also a website through which you can have number of journals access. You can also go to Taylor and Francis. You can also go to Science Direct. You can also have some access to JSTOR, where you can find number of research papers. You can have search engines through which you can limit your research to particular key terms and search terms. You can also limit to your research to, let's say, time period, for example, 2000 to 2010, 1980 to 1990, 1970 to 2010, whatever you want to. You have an advanced search option where you can have limits, access this or that, what kind of keywords or terms you want to have access to, and all these kind of options are there. So you can start searching journals through these digital libraries if you have access to this HEC digital library. And journals are the vital source because they publish the ongoing cross-cutting research which can help you understand, rephrase, refine, and rewrite your research questions and objectives. And once you get some articles from the journal, references given in the end of these journal articles actually help you to start searching more articles relevant to your research inquiry. And in this way, you can be in a position to have access to more articles relevant to your research area. And the research journal is actually covered by secondary literature, and good selection can be accessed from which is already discussed, through HEC digital library for that matter, or online library of HEC. So journal articles basically gives you not only theoretical stuff but also methodological stuff. So you can not only have access to theoretical frameworks that you are looking for, but you can also understand what kind of data they used, what kind of methodologies they are employing. You can also find some criticism on the previous studies by the article you are reading. And based on that criticism, you can also strengthen your point and also criticize the same paper that you are reading. So in this way, kind of snowballing things occur, that you not only get that paper, but the references that are given in the end of that paper helps you to find some more paper. And from these papers, you can also go and see their references. And in that way, you can have access to, let's say, book chapters. You can have access to periodicals. You can have access to online working papers that are not yet published but are available online. And number of other sources which are already given in the references of these papers. So this is how journal or refereed and academic articles are very, very important sources. Articles in refereed academic journal, for example, the Journal of Finance, Journal of Human Resource Management, are evaluated by peers academic prior to publication. So one thing that is very important is that whatever paper published in these journals, they are already reviewed, refined, commented, suggested, criticized by at least two evaluators, commentators, reviewers to assess their quality and suitability. And they are usually written by experts in the field. So those who are writing the papers, for example, on financial econometrics, for example, on human resource management issues, marketing stuff, advertisement, price and stock exchanges, and all these kind of issues, they are having some expertise developed in these areas. That's why they are researching on those areas of particular concern, and they are writing papers that they submit to journal editor, which is assigned to reviewers, at least one or two. People read these articles and then criticize, comment, and suggest changes. And based on that changes, then the paper got accepted or rejected. And if the paper is got accepted, then definitely it has already assessed, so the quality is kind of ensured. That is why journal article are the more quality source for literature search. Usually contain detailed footnotes, an extensive bibliography, rigorous attention to detail and verification of information. So they definitely have some footnotes from where you can also learn various kind of subheading things, various kind of things that are not in the mainstream write-up, but they are under the footnote headings. So you can also understand some basics from these published articles. And they also contain extensive bibliography. They can have references or they can have bibliography. I have already explained that references are only those things that you have cited in your paper when you write the paper. While bibliography is a little different than when you cite other sources than you have cited in the paper. But they are also relevant to the research area you are working on. So this is how they help you, the references or bibliography help you to find out sources that can have link to the research question or objectives of your study. And there is verification of information because the journal paper is already peer reviewed by at least two reviewers or one reviewer, maybe more than two reviewers also. They are written for more narrow audience, specific audience with a particular interest in the field. So we have talked about the Journal of Finance. Journal of Finance definitely contain papers or include papers that are relevant to the issues of finance. So those who are writing on financial issues, financial economics issues, financial econometric issues, financial globalization issues, stock market issues, finance and economic relationships, so they can have access to articles through this journal, let's say the Journal of Finance. So this is how the important thing is that if you know what kind of research topic you are researching on, you can have access to various specific journals on that topic. They can help you provide number of journal articles, number of papers, summary articles, commentaries that can help you understand what is already existing and what kind of gaps your study can also fill. So they are written for more narrow and interested particular audience. Finally, they have language used that is technical and highly specialized. So if you are interested in an article which is written on financial globalization, they might have some terms that are jargons used in that particular field of study. They are very technically written. So these are some of the things that one has to understand when they are looking for journal articles. For example, books are little different than the journal articles. When we talk about journal articles, we always have in mind that they are quality oriented, their information is verified, they are written for narrow or particular interested audience, and they can have some jargons and a specific language or terms used for that particular area. What about books? Books and monographs are written for a specific audience as well, but they are not too narrow down that they can only talking about finance, for example. I mean, book can also be on a particular issue, but that is not narrowed down to particular audiences. So that's also for a specific audience, but it's not that particular that it only covers few important aspects. Have theoretical and or practical focus. So book can have theoretical or practical focus or have both. So book can be written on issues of how theories are developing with the passage of time in that line of research area, or how empirical studies are focusing on one or the other way to prove this or that kind of theory. Or maybe a book can have theoretical frameworks, conceptual frameworks, and based on that conceptual framework, they can also have some empirical stuff that verifies or nullifies the theory or conceptual framework that is presented in the book. Book material is more ordered and accessible than in journals. So book is more ordered material, ordered in the sense that it starts from pointing out what is the focus of the book, then they build the some basic ideas about it. And if you have seen some books, they also come up about the details of what this topic is all about, how it is conducting, how it is going on, what are the main research focuses that has already been done. Because it is a detailed thing, a research article can be at most like 20, 25, 30 pages, but book must have been like more than 100, 150, or maybe more than 200, 300 pages. So you have at least leverage of explaining things in detail or in more detail than in research paper in a journal. In 20 pages, you can squeeze down the information in few lines or paragraphs, but in books you can have information on number of pages. So this is how book material is more order sequenced and in better detail relative to journal articles, particularly used for introductory sources to help clarify your research questions and objectives or research method you intend to use. So for example, book helps you to introduce with the topic of your area, with the topic of your interest. These books can also help you to improve your research questions and objectives, and they can have also impact on the methods that you want to use or intend to use. So books help in various ways. Journal articles can have a specific focus: theoretical, empirical, data analysis, methodology. One aspect is very strongly covered in theoretical article, in journal articles normally. But in books, most of these aspects are covered in various chapters that can help you understand the basics of your topic, the basics of your research questions and objectives. And based on that, you can actually identify where you can have some misunderstandings of the points that you want to clarify. So thinking in those line of inquiries, looking into the book material and joining your research question and objective with that of the theory or conceptual framework, you can actually refine, redefine or rewrite your research question and objective. This way book become a more helpful material relative to journal articles. Nevertheless, journal articles focus is one important aspect of your research inquiry. Book can be very general in that particular sense, but it's also a basic source. And journal article can be very focused to a very minute detail, but it can have a focus which can help you to understand your methodology or data, which can help you to understand your conceptual framework or analysis. And in this way, you can understand what kind of research is going on in that line of inquiry or the area of research you want to conduct research on, and how your study can add to the knowledge, to the existing knowledge. Now, this is how we distinguish between journal articles and books. Why search strategy planning is needed? When we start searching, for example, journal articles, or when we start searching, for example, book chapters or books, why do we need to have a plan for that? Number one, literature search is a time consuming process. So this is one of the very important aspects that we have to keep in mind. Second, we can have overload of information. Third, we have to clearly define objectives, research questions that are necessarily having a focus. If we are unable to do that, we will not be in a position to search research journals or articles. So we have to keep in mind three important things. Time, because we might have, let's say, one or two semesters to conduct our master thesis or graduate level thesis. If this is the case and we start searching everything that comes our way, we might lose up ending nowhere. So this is one of the very important things. We have to think critically, we have to plan systematically so that we don't lose time, and we can also maximize our search so that we can have access to not only articles that published, let's say, 10 years back, but we can have also access to articles that are recently published, that is recent going research on that research area. So the other important thing why we have to plan research strategy is that we have to avoid overloading of information. If you write one single word in Google search and you click search, you might find more than 50,000 searches. And if you start looking each and every aspect, you end up nowhere, because you may miss like 5-7 days just to look into these 50,000 or 60,000 searches that you have got by writing just one word. So you have to be very particular. You have to be very particular. Rather than searching in Google very generally, you can go to, let's say, Springer, where you can have search and advanced search option, where you can limit this or that way. You can enter various search terms, and based on that, you can find very specific articles that are published on the research area you are interested in. This is one way of minimizing the overburdening of information. Secondly, that can also help you to reduce your time consumption. So in that way, if you don't plan, you number one lose your time, number two you will get overburdened from information, and that can have some deleterious effect on your research strategy. So that is why we have to have a planned research strategy or planned search strategy. Before we start searching, we have to have a clearly defined objectives, research questions, and they must have a necessarily focused attention. We have to have focused research questions and objectives. Once we have that, we start searching by entering key terms, keywords, and then we limit it to, let's say, 10 years time period, 20 years time period, 30 years time period, and we start from, let's say, journal articles or and books, or only journal articles, and then we give command to various sites where we can retrieve some of the literature that we are interested in. And this is how we have to plan our search strategy to avoid, number one, more time consumption, that we don't waste our important precious time. Number two, we have to avoid overburdening of information. If more information or overburdened information came to us, we might lose our focus. And if we lose our focus, we actually detract ourselves from the research we want to conduct. And before that, we have to have clearly defined focused research objectives and research questions. And that is one of the very necessary important point. Strategy of literature search. What do we have to do? I think this is the same thing that we have seen, or clearly same things that we have seen in the circular upward moving cycle, where we have seen that we have to have a research question and objective that help us to determine parameters. Parameters help us to determine keywords and key terms. There, using these keywords and key terms, we start searching something, we conduct search, we retrieve some papers, we evaluate based on inclusion and inclusion criteria, and then the search goes on in circular way. So similarly, we have to have a strategy for literature search, and for that matter, we need parameters, we need keywords and search terms, we need databases and search engines, we have to have criteria of selection of relevant articles, and we have to discuss with our peer, tutor, or supervisor, senior researcher, friends who are conducting research on the similar line of inquiry. So, number one, we have to have clear parameters based on which we want to start our search. Based on these parameters, we have to define some keywords and search terms. Once we define keywords and search terms, then we definitely have to understand that what kind of databases we can have access to and what kind of search engines we can start searching. So one of the databases that I told you is this HEC Digital Library, through which we can have access to number of other databases. That is, for example, ScienceDirect, Elsevier, JSTOR, ISI Web of Knowledge, Taylor & Francis, Springer, number of other databases. Search engines can be Google Scholar, Google, various other search engines. So through these, we will be in a position to use our key terms and search words to retrieve some literature, maybe journal article, maybe magazine article, maybe academic refereed article, maybe a book chapter, a dissertation that is already published, or conference proceedings. So these databases and search engine help us to know, by entering our search terms, we'll be in a position to see where we can have access to this or that kind of article, book chapter, or conference proceedings. And we have to have a selection criteria for relevance of the article, that is whether we have to include this article to our literature review or not. For this reason, what criteria we are using, we have to have a certain criteria for inclusion or exclusion of that particular article. And based on all these things, we have to discuss all these four steps with our research supervisor, tutor, peers, friends, senior researchers who are doing the same kind of research, so that we can understand whether we are moving in the right direction or not, where we can have some improvements, where we can find some more sources. For example, they can have tell us that there are journals which are not available on these databases, but you can access them from some other databases, or maybe just through various websites of the universities. So this is how we can access, through discussion, new websites, search engines, and databases. This also helps us not only to follow the given things, but we can also supplement them from other sources as well. So what are the parameters for our search strategy? There are few things that one have to clear about. A researcher must know the parameters of his or her search strategy before conducting a literature search. One is language. That's very important. When you write something in the search or advanced search options, you have to be very careful about the spellings of that particular keyword or search term, so that you avoid missing out one or the other important phrase and you cannot retrieve some of the general important journal articles. So you have to be very critical in choosing your key terms and key search words, and also you have to check their spelling. For example, if you're writing in English or any other language, let's say Spanish or French. So language is one of the important thing. Language means that whatever language you are using, you have to check out spellings. If you just write a one word mistake, you might not retrieve a single research paper. That can hamper your looking for literature search. So you have to write simple key terms with right spellings. Second is subject area. You have to be very focused about your subject area. You have to understand whether you're talking about human resource management, or you're talking about finance, or you're talking about marketing. If you're not clear about these broader research areas or subject areas, you're definitely going to lose one or the other research articles or maybe book chapters that is important, relevant to your research area. You have to be sector or particular focus. Within that broader research area or subject area, you have to have a particular focus. So you must know that sectoral focus or particular focus. For example, in finance, you might be talking about banking or a stock exchange. Or in marketing, you're talking about advertisement. Or in human resource management, you're talking about top level employee and conflict between various governing bodies within an organization. So you have to understand whether you want to research on a stock exchange or banking sector and or any other services sector you are interested in. So language is very important. Then comes the subject area of your focus, and then comes the sectoral or particular focus. And also you have to understand the geographical focus of your study? Is it regional, covering, let's say, South Asia? Is it national, let's say, covering one country, Pakistan? Is it urban, maybe focusing only on Karachi Stock Exchange or Islamabad or Lahore Stock Exchange? Or rural, maybe marketing in rural areas? For example, these are the geographical focus that one has to understand when you are defining parameters for your search strategy. Literature type. You have to understand that what kind of literature you need. You need book chapters, you need journal articles, you need magazines, you need only abstract, you need conference proceedings, or you need all. And then, of course, you need publication period. You want only for 10 years, let's say 2000 to 2010. You need for, let's say, 20 years, 1990 to 2010. You need for 30 years, 1980. You need only from 1970 to 1980. Or you need from across the period, that is, let's say, from 1950 to 2012. So, publication period is also very important. Maybe the research area you want to inquire about have most number of publication from 1960 to 1980, but very less research is conducted on that particular research area in 2000 or 1990s. So you have to see not only the latest papers, but also the previous published paper on your area of research. So when you defining the parameters of your search strategy, you as a researcher have to keep these five very basic points in mind. One is language. You have to think clearly whether the language is clear to you or not. You want to search in English or Spanish, or you want to search in any language. So you have to clarify, specify which language research you are conducting. Once you clarify about this, you have to write clear-cut spellings of the keywords or search term that you want to search on. Then you have to focus on your subject or research area, that is finance, marketing, human resource management, or any other research area. Then you have to understand and also know about the sectoral focus of your research. Maybe stock exchange, banking, services, advertisement, what and where you want to focus on. Geographical focus is also very important. Is it a regional study? Is it a national? Is it urban versus rural? What is the geographical focus of your research? Then you have to know what kind of literature type you are looking for. You are looking for journal articles, magazines, abstracts, conference proceedings, or you're looking for book chapters, or you're looking for all the options that is available. And then you will also have to be clear in your mind that what is the time length or publication period you are looking for. You're looking for 10 years latest, you're looking for 20 years, or maybe you're looking for, let's say, 30, 40 years, or you're looking for 1960 to something like that. So you have to be clear about publication period. Once you are in a position to define these parameters for your search strategy, you will be in a good position to understand how you can define the keywords. Keywords are very important at early stages. Number one, they are important to read both articles by key authors and recent review articles in your area of research. So once you are in a position to retrieve, to get some of the literature that is written by key authors, or you are in a position to get an article which is a review article, then you will be in a good position at your starting stage to start looking at the whole debate about the research area you are focusing on. So that's why keywords are very important to search the mainstream important literature that you are looking for. So once you get 2-3 papers of key authors or a review article, they can help you to define or refine or redefine the appropriate keywords. Once you are in a position to get, let's say, few nice journal articles written by key authors, or you can get 1 or 2 review articles, then you'll be in a good position to refine your keywords. and when you are in a position to refine your keywords, that can also improve your search strategy. That can also help you to focusedly search on the research area of your inquiry. Secondly, these review articles or articles written by key authors helps you to find some important references of other works that is applicable to your research questions and objectives. So if you find a review article in the end where you can find references or bibliography of that paper, you can have access or you can actually find some titles that are relevant to your research questions and objectives. So from there, you can also find some more articles relevant to that. You can also have access to some books that are relevant to the research area. And if you are unsure about review articles, ask your tutor or supervisor. If you get an article which is a review article and you think that it is a review article in that broader field of research inquiry but not focusing on where you are interested in, or you kind of get confused that we are focusing on some other aspect where review article or key author's article are not focusing on, so you can also have a helping hand from your supervisor or tutor. Whenever you have this kind of confusion, you can discuss with your peers, you can discuss with your tutor or friends, you can also go and directly discuss to your supervisor. Dissertation and thesis in your university's library can be a potential source of references. Dissertations that are available in your university library or department library can also help you to provide some helping hand. You can also find some important stuff from there. You can also look into their references, and from there you can find something that are very important for you. You can find from references some titles that are more important for you or that are very relevant to the research area of your research inquiry. You now need to define precisely what is relevant to your research in terms of keywords. Once you have, let's say, access to few relevant articles written by key authors or a review chapter, you can define or refine your keywords, and based on that you can talk about your supervisor whether you are interested in this or that kind of stuff. You can also have an access to your dissertation in your library or the departmental library or the organization you are working for, and based on these few searches you will be in a good position to define the precise keywords and terms that you are looking for. And that is the most important point when you have to identify keywords or search term for your search that is relevant to your relevant to the topic of your research. So identification of keywords or search term is the most important part of planning your search for relevant literature. To find relevant literature, it is very important for you to have few important keywords that can actually be used to access or to have access to various literatures that you are interested in. And that's one of the very important thing that one has to keep in mind always. Keywords are the basic terms that describe your research questions and objectives. You can also find or get some keywords or search terms from your research questions that you have already asked and the research objectives that you have set in. Once you are done with your keywords and research terms, search objectives, you can get some search or keywords from there, and you can start looking at various databases and search engines using these keywords and search terms. So finding, refining, redefining keywords from various ways and means and using various sources, that's one of the most important thing. Why it is important? Because it helps us to find the most relevant literature that is related to the area of your research. So this can be used by accessing through few articles written by key authors or a review article written by one or the other person, and from those articles you can have access to few more keywords or search term. You can refine or redefine your keywords and search term. You can also have access to dissertations or theses in your library or department library. And you can also, based on if you have any confusion, you can discuss with your tutor or supervisor. And based on these discussions and searches, you can now be in a position to define your keywords in an appropriate way. Once you are in a position to define your specific focused keywords or search terms, you will be in a good position to retrieve literature that is more relevant to the research questions and objectives you want to answer. And in that way, your most important aspect or most important aspect of retrieving literature is completed, in the sense that now you have refined keywords based on which you can have access to relevant literature that will definitely help you pinpoint some of the most important aspect of the research. How to minimize problems with keywords? As we have already discussed, we have to understand which language we are interested in, English or any other language. We have to focus on spellings also. Simple mistake of one word in spellings can destroy the whole search process. So you have to be very focused when you are writing a keyword or search term. Use of incorrect terminology. You have to have correct terminology that you want to retrieve through using one or the other keyword or search term. Terminology is used properly so that you cannot misspecify one or the other term, and that misspecification leads you to irrelevant literature. So this is one of the very important aspects, that not only you have to be careful about the spellings, but you have to be careful about the terminology you are using. Use recognized acronyms and abbreviations. You have to use recognized abbreviations. For example, UK is used for United Kingdom, which is globally everywhere you used UK. USA, United States of America. You're using that term everywhere this term is used. US dollar, US, and then we put S with two slashes. So this is US dollar. If you just put dollar, then nobody understands whether it is Australian dollar, Canadian dollar, or somewhere else. So you have to be clear about the abbreviations that you are using. If you put unclear abbreviations, you might end up finding nothing from the literature search. Avoiding jargon and using accepted terminology. You have to avoid jargons that are normally used in let's say press or one or the other magazines, but you have to use the terminology that is normally used in, let's say, peer-reviewed journal articles, or in the book chapters, or the literature that you have focused on or searched or you have read. So you have to focus on terminology rather than jargons. These are the four very important points we have to keep in mind. Number one, we have to do a spell check. We have to write correct spellings. We have to avoid using incorrect terminology. We have to recognize abbreviations and acronyms, correct, that are accepted globally. For example, UK, USA. And we have to avoid jargons, and we have to use accepted terminology. So once you do all these things, you have few points to ponder on. Number one, you have to discuss with yourself what kind of keywords you actually need to find literature that is relevant to you. You have to discuss with yourself, that is self-discussion, whether the keywords or search term that you have come up with make sense for you, or when you use them in search engines or databases, will you retrieve the relevant journal articles, for example? If this is the case, you self-satisfies yourself. If this is not the case, what you will do, you go and discuss with your tutor and supervisor. Either you try to refine or redefine your search term, or you go and talk about these things with your tutor or supervisor. You have to discuss with the peers, friends, and academics. Once you discuss with tutor or supervisor, you'll definitely go and discuss with your friends and peers and other academic people so that you can have access to one or the other relevant literature and you don't miss the most important studies that you want to focus on. These are the few things that I want to tell you, that these are the bibliographic details when you read a journal, when you read a book chapter, or when you read a chapter in an edited book. So bibliographic detail you have to provide in the reference and also in the citation. So for example, I'm just reading few things from journal, rest you can also see. So you have to tell author's or author or author's name or surname, first name, initials, year of publication, in parentheses always, title of article, title of journal, sometime underlined, sometime not, sometime in italics. You have to tell about the volume, you have to talk about part or issue, and then you have to write the page numbers, preceded by sometimes P dot or sometime PP dot, or in various styles of referencing, you don't have to write any kind of P or PP, but you just have to write page numbers, let's say from 23 to 47. So this is how you can give bibliographic details of journal. Same is the case with book and edited chapters in the book. So this is how you have to understand that these particular details you have to provide when you are referencing one or the other article from book, from journal, or from edited book. So we have to understand these bibliographic details, that we need author's names and surnames, year of publication in parentheses, title of the article, title of the journal, sometime underlined, most of the time not, volume, issue, page numbers, with P dot, with P, P dot, or without any P. So this is how you can complete your reference with journals. In book you have to do that, and then for the chapter in edited book also. The final slide of today's lecture is about plagiarism, which is a very important and immensely emphasized thing if you talk about HEC rules of publication and HEC rules of writing a dissertation. Plagiarism is one of the very, very important aspect and ethical issue when it comes to research and researchers. We have to clearly cite the words, theories, or arguments presented in one or the other paper or book chapter which is not by us, which is not our own words. We have to cite them clearly when we are writing our research paper. Plagiarism can be of following nature: stealing material from other sources. You take material from other sources, you put it in your research paper or dissertation and you don't cite. Submitting material not written by you. Someone has written a paper, he or she has asked you to comment on that, and you just get that paper, submit it to a journal unethically, showing that this is written by you. Copying material without quoting. You copy few lines from a book chapter or a journal article, you paste it in your dissertation, one or the other page, and you say that this is also your own argument, and you don't cite the source. Paraphrasing material without documentation. You rewrite few of the arguments and you don't cite the person's reference in that particular thing. You can rewrite it, but the argument does not belong to you. So these are four key ways in which a researcher become unethical and commit plagiarism. This is very, very important aspect. You have to avoid it as much as you can so that your research can be purely yours, and also you avoid some unethical behavior on your part. This is one of the very important part of your research that you can avoid, and you must avoid to be ethical and don't be unethical. Plagiarism is one of the most important aspect when you write a research paper and you quote other people's work. You have to cite them clearly and you have to reference them in the end of the article. We'll talk about plagiarism not in much detail, but we'll definitely talk about for few more important aspects of plagiarism, and we will be talking about ethics in research. So today we are ending here. Let me summarize briefly that we have talked about the sources of literature in today's lecture, where we have seen that we have primary, secondary and tertiary sources, and we have seen that the most important sources of literature search are journal articles and book chapters. They can be book chapters in edited book, or they can be book chapters in one volume published book. Why journal articles are important? Because they have narrow focus, they have clear theoretical conceptual and focused research agenda, which is already reviewed by one or two peer reviewers, and that has quality check and also criticized by those reviewers. So that's why we can access journal articles for very important reasons, that their quality is already checked. Book chapter is also the same thing, which has relatively broader focus, can have basic source of material, and which is also very important nature of material. And we have also seen the parameters of our research, our search words or key terms, why they are important, why we have to focus on keywords and search term, what is the important things to focus on, for example spelling, for example what kind of search strategy we want to use, and for example why we have to ask from our supervisor when we are unable to find some relevant literature. And in the end, we have discussed about plagiarism, which is unethical if a researcher quotes somebody's work without citing that particular person's reference and citation in his research work, dissertation, research paper or book article. We have to understand these things very clearly so that we can start again scientifically, systematically and rigorously to find relevant literature, to write literature review critically. We end up here and we start in our next lecture from here where we are ending. Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum.